Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Wealth Choice, Success Secrets of Black Millionaires, by Dennis Kimbro, narrated by Bill Andrew Quinn. Introduction. A wealth of knowledge, the most powerful economic weapon. The first law of wealth. If you don't know better, you can't do better. John Hope Bryant. Why aren't you rich? John H. Johnson, the founder and chief executive of Ebony Magazine, the nation's leading black publication, fired at me as I sat across from his desk in his plush Chicago headquarters. Caught off guard, I had never considered his question. I suggest that you consider the gifts that you've been given, Johnson continued. You and your generation live in an era of unprecedented wealth and growth. More men and women have become wealthy in the last 20 years than any other time in human history. You've been given a sound mind and sound body, not to mention an energetic spirit as well as opportunity at every turn. And to top it off, you've earned a degree from one of the finest schools in the country. Again, the publishing tycoon repeated his question, this time demanding the answer. Why aren't you wealthy? I sat motionless and ashamed. Ashamed that I could not answer his question. Ashamed that I had failed to grasp past opportunities. Ashamed that I had failed to realize that wasted time means wasted energy, wasted talents, and wasted potential. I now know that time is money. No one should waste an hour any more than we should waste a dollar bill. But most important, I was ashamed because I had failed to cultivate, nurture, and emulate Johnson's passion and purpose for life. The millionaires among us are men and women of laser-like focus and concentration, wealth creators who have hammered away at one place long enough to accomplish their purpose. In a world of mostly have-nots, the wealthy and influential tend to be individuals with one overriding objective, one unwavering aim. Ironically, the man or woman who is forever looking about to see what he or she can find never finds a thing. In short, we find what we seek with all our heart and, if we look for nothing in particular, guess what? We find just that. I was ashamed because I was finally forced to answer to a man who served as my judge and jury. Johnson, a one-time have-not, had spent the better part of 3 decades crafting articles at night and peddling them during the day before he was given the chance to demonstrate his powers of persuasion to the world of commerce. After starting Ebony, he became a multimillionaire by age 40. A weaker spirit would have quit years ago. And this remarkably committed individual unselfishly carved out a piece of his day to school me on the demands of wealth. If you want to know how people feel about themselves, Johnson reasoned, look at their bank account. Money is the greatest measurement of your mindset. There are thousands of men and women who have lost every material possession, and yet, because they possess a stout heart, an unconquerable will, and the determination to push ahead, they are just as far from poverty as before their loss. Here lies the good news. Wealth is less a matter of circumstance than it is a matter of knowledge and choice. With such wealth, no one should ever be poor. You must take control of your life. You must make the decision to be wealthy. When the student is ready. During an economics class at Atlanta University, an inquisitive student asked the scholar and educator W.E.B. Du Bois for the quickest and surest way to prosperity. What I am about to share, Dr. Du Bois replied, you would do well to write on your heart and place in your purse. Many a ruined man dates his downfall from the day he began buying what he did not need. If you are in debt, part of you belongs to your creditors. To whom you give your money, you give your power. More than a century later, Du Bois's words still resonate. Money is, arguably, one of humanity's greatest tools. Regardless of the heat it generates, money is like any other resource or commodity, neither good nor bad, neither sinful nor sacred. Unlike other resources, however, money evolves from the thought processes of those who possess it. It is an instrument, a standard that can be used for both good and evil, by the rich and the not-so-rich, by the haves as well as the have-nots. to many of us, like the inquisitive student just described, fail to understand the importance of financial management. Only one path connects poverty and great wealth: the long and rugged road of faith, family, and hard work. What the marketplace wants are men and women with the ambition and nerve to work and wait, whether the world applauds, criticizes, or condemns them. Wealth requires a Janice Bryant Howroyd, who spent more than 25 years staring down hard times and toiling as a little fish in a big pond, building her one-woman temporary employment agency into a major corporate player. Long dismissed by the competition, Howroyd built her business brick by brick from a tiny Southern California office. She was raised as one of 11 children in the segregated South, and it wasn't until Howroyd took an economics course in college that she realized the depth of her childhood poverty. But in spite of this, her family surrounded her, as they did each of their children, with love, self-confidence, and an insatiable thirst for academic excellence. With less than $1,500 in savings and personal loans, this devoutly spiritual woman founded the Act One Group, one of the largest female and minority-owned companies in the country, boasting annual revenues of more than $600 million. What is the source of her wealth? Not genius, deep pockets, or well-placed contacts, but an unshakable faith matched by tireless passion and energy. Here's the secret that she personally shared with me nearly a decade ago. To some people, $500 million seems like a vast sum of money. However, I've invested darn near every dime I earned back into my company. I refuse to fall prey to the bling-bling life. I've learned early on the power of the words, "I can't afford it." Each day, men and women go to their graves in obscurity because timidity prevented them from making a start or at least an initial effort. If they had just begun, in all likelihood, they would have found their calling and achieved financial success. Reginald F. Lewis never knew when he was beaten. The words that were written on his heart throughout his life are now etched on his headstone: "Keep going, no matter what." This was Lewis's mantra as he struck the single deal that not only transformed his investment firm, the TLC Group, but black-owned business as well. In 1984, with only $1 million in cash and $24 million in borrowed funds, Lewis snapped up the Manhattan McCall Pattern Company, intent on revitalizing the 117-year-old sewing pattern maker. Just a year later, he shocked the financial community by selling McCall's to the John Crowther Group, a British textile maker, for $63 million. Moreover, Crowther agreed to take on $32 million in debt owed by the pattern company. For TLC, the deal meant a remarkable 80-to-1 return on its initial $1 million investment. That coup ensured Lewis a top spot in Wall Street's financial community as he engineered TLC's next major transaction, the takeover of Beatrice International, a global food manufacturer valued at $985 million. The odds may be 1,000,000-to-1 against reaching your financial goals, but ever-present opportunities can shift the prospects in your favor if you just use your God-given talents and act. Why stand there with folded arms begging the Creator for blessings that He has already bestowed? Hasn't He given you the necessary faculties and strengths? Hasn't He blessed you with a sound mind and sturdy body? Is there no way in which you can utilize each passing moment to improve your condition and be of benefit to others? Are all the seats taken? Are all the positions filled? Are the resources of our great nation fully developed? Is the competition so fierce that you won't even try? With a world stacked with work that needs to be done and countless examples to encourage you to dare and find your highest good and true calling, why wait? Remember when the Israelites found themselves caught between Pharaoh's army and the crashing waves of the Red Sea, Moses asked for divine help. And the response? The Lord of Heavenly Host questioned, "Why dost thou criest unto me? Tell the children of Israel to go forward." In other words, pay heed to your passion and seize the hour. So you want to be a millionaire? Lack of opportunity is the excuse of the timid and the fearful. Opportunities? They are everywhere. A new era is dawning. Thousands of men and women have made their fortune from ideas that others pass by or dismiss. Just as the bee creates honey from the same flower that the spider saps its poison, some men and women will produce their riches from the most common, trivial ideas that others discard. Countless positions that were closed only decades ago are now inviting you and me to enter. There is latent power everywhere waiting for the observant eye to discover. If it is wealth that you seek, study yourself, your own needs and wants. Opportunities? Every life is full of opportunity. Every breath, every moment, and every encounter is an opportunity. An opportunity to look past the traditional, to step over outdated methods, and to ignore the words, "That's the way it has always been done." Every classroom, every book, and every lesson is an opportunity. An opportunity to prove and improve yourself. An opportunity to say yes, though the world says no. An opportunity to put it all on the line. And an opportunity to immerse yourself in the dream buried in your heart. Every business transaction is an opportunity. An opportunity to serve. An opportunity to make a difference. An opportunity to test market conditions. An opportunity to stamp your brand. And an opportunity to let your light so shine and glorify your Father in heaven. Spot and seize opportunities as if they were gold, are the words written above the door leading to prosperity, and who should know better than Don Barden? Growing up in the shipyards of Cleveland, Ohio, Barden valued ambition and determination over money and connections before finding his place in the field of enterprise. Extremely driven, Barden told those in his inner circle, "I had to control the events of my life. It was my call. Either sulk and languish in poverty or carry out my plans regardless of the opinion of others. In the end, if you take care of business, your business will take care of you." Barden realized that the only way you can truly get ahead is by venturing into areas where others fear to tread. At last count, this casino operator and real estate developer was worth more than $500 million. Wealth requires a Maggie Lena Walker to hold her ground and push without fear or trepidation. At the turn of the 20th century, Walker was not a promising candidate for financial success by any measure. She was penniless in a world that valued wealth, a female in a society that favored males, and a woman of color who sought riches in an arena where skin color mattered most. In 1903, through sound fiscal policies and boundless energy, Walker became the first woman, black or white, to charter a U.S. bank, the St. Luke Penny Savings. Refusing to be intimidated by poverty or racial injustice, she would counsel all those who would listen. "No one can prosper when they expect to remain poor. Let's invest our money and reap the benefit ourselves." As her financial empire grew, Walker knew that besides providing the power to transform ideas, wealth equals freedom. The giants of the race have been men and women of exquisite concentration, individuals who just kept hammering away at one place until they reached their objective. If you're wondering what makes people wealthy, look no further than perseverance in spite of every difficulty, courage that enables you to overcome all trials and disappointment, and a single unwavering aim matched by intense purpose. There is no open door to the temple of wealth. Whoever dares to enter must forge his or her own way. "There is no secret to amassing wealth," Lisa Nicole Clout declared as she stood before a room packed with teary-eyed women from every economic strata and walk of life. "Ladies," this powerhouse of a motivator barked during a standing-room-only sales rally, "the key to wealth is within your reach, but you must design your life or someone else will." "I've walked in your shoes," she continued. "I've been rejected, ridiculed, and kicked to the curb. Believe me, I know what you're going through. My journey from bootstraps to big time did not occur overnight. Plenty of nights I sank to my knees asking God to reveal His purpose, His divine plan. My turning point occurred when a dear friend, a mentor, someone whom I respect and admire, said to me during one of the lowest points in my life, "Lisa, you will either live your dreams or live your fears. The only barrier that stands between you and what you want out of life is the will to try and the faith to believe in your dreams." Those words of wisdom changed her life. 5 years ago, Cloud navigated the same road of uncertainty and instability as most employees who struggle within the corporate framework. As a pharmaceutical sales rep, each day she wondered if and when she would fall victim to corporate downsizing. She realized that the security she had once felt in her career was gone, and she had to do something different. She began exploring a variety of business opportunities and soon discovered a new venture in the voiceover internet protocol, VOIP, / direct sales arena. With a modest startup investment, Cloud decided to launch her own VOIP telecom business in the direct sales industry. Devoting every spare moment to realizing her dream, her strong work ethic has paid off handsomely. Not only has she created unbelievable success for herself, she is internationally known as the Millionaire Maker, training and developing tens of thousands of direct sales associates around the world, many of whom boast seven-figure incomes. Cloud's message is on point and simple. Turn potential into performance and adhere to the traits and qualities of the financial elite who live life on their terms. Opportunities, you ask? Opportunities are endless. And she should know. Still in her mid-30s, she has already been dubbed the Queen of Direct Sales. At a time when opportunity and wealth call out and demand the best in each of us, Tyrese Gibson stands out as the ultimate icon of nerve, imagination, and fortitude. Gibson wasn't destined for stardom. Raised by a single mother in the rough and unforgiving neighborhood of South Central Los Angeles, he was statistically more likely to be a victim of a drive-by shooting than a financial success. Gibson was 6 years old when his father left the family of four children. Instead of succumbing to the crime-infested streets, Gibson decided to battle his way out. "It was far from easy," he shared with me after speaking to my freshman business seminar class, "but I always believed in myself and that I could overcome any odds. Poverty and confusion are not deterrents to success." As a child, his household was filled with the sounds of the soulful balladeers, including Stevie Wonder, Donny Hathaway, and Marvin Gaye. Between those rhythm and blues giants and his mother, Gibson was inspired to never be caught without a song in his heart or a melody on his lips. In other words, he pursued his hobby of singing. In 1995, that hobby turned into a career. Gibson answered a casting call posted on the wall in his high school. A local public relations firm was combing the area searching for an African-American male to serve in the lead role in a soft drink promotional campaign. Gibson didn't hesitate. Unable to find a ride to the audition, he rode a city bus instead and was 2 hours late for his appointment. Ironically, the producer and ad agency director were caught in the same traffic. Despite the delay, and never one to be weakened by excuses, the budding entertainer convinced the director that he, Gibson, was born for the part. When the curtain fell on his first take in a makeshift back alley studio, his reputation was made. Thanks to his achievements, Gibson is now known to millions as a multi-platinum singer, songwriter, actor, fashion model, and author. When I asked for the keys to financial empowerment, he stood to make his point. Attack your dreams with a solitary purpose and vision, and learn to get out of your own way. Opportunities? They are all around us. The surest and quickest way to a fortune is through humanity's prime necessities. Each of us is forced to toil for our own food, shelter, and clothing. Although initially people may struggle, anyone who was wise enough to supply society's wants, prudent enough to improve the methods that humanity can use, and clever enough to offer comfort, leisure, and peace of mind to the well-being of others will eventually rise to distinction. Riches are lying everywhere for the observant eye. Many of us who believe we are poor are rich in possibilities. Why the wealth choice? And why now? In spite of Black America's advances, only 40 years removed from the Civil Rights Movement, with more successful educated and accomplished entrepreneurs and corporate professionals than at any other time in history, the journey is far from over. To be honest, it is only beginning. These pockets of prosperity, a gulf as vast and deep as the Nile, separates the majority of the black community from its financial elites as well as from virtually every other ethnic group in our society. The abyss between wealthy blacks and poverty-stricken blacks is more than disturbing. The unemployment rate for young black males in some urban areas is fast approaching Great Depression levels. More black males than ever are incarcerated, attend miserably failing segregated inner-city schools, and live in gang-infested, crime-ridden neighborhoods. These impoverished enclaves have become the equivalent of a domestic third-world country. But these are not problems without solutions. Though the challenges that confront this market segment may be deep and vast and may desperately need addressing, the purpose of this book is to highlight the infinite possibilities that are available to all who inhabit the world, possibilities that have been brought to my attention and clarified by Black America's wealthiest. Unfortunately, you would be hard-pressed to find a course in our educational system titled Wealth 101. Few of us are even taught the basics rudiment of money, how to make it, keep it, share it, and open our hands to it. Over the years, I have learned that much of the accepted wisdom about race and economics is based on conjecture rather than fact. It would take a lifetime to untangle the myths, inaccuracies, and stereotypes that cloud the black experience. And the most mindless idea of our time is that wealth, in general, or millionaireship specifically, is attainable only by those of a certain class, race, or economic stratum. As this book will prove, nothing can be further from the truth. You, the listener, will come to understand that building a seven-figure income requires more than a successful enterprise or career. In fact, much more. The wealth creators interviewed for this study were quite clear regarding the path to wealth, not to mention the bigger picture, financial empowerment. The millionaires profiled here are convinced that Black America's top priority for the 21st century should be closing the wealth gap. With regard to wealth, prosperity, and fiscal fitness and awareness, what do black millionaires know that so people fail to comprehend? These wealth creators know that our prosperity as a nation depends on the personal financial prosperity of each individual. They know that proper preparation is the key to financial success. They know that if you invest in yourself, you will never be poor, and that if you ask for little, you will receive little. They know that debt is like any other trap, easy to tumble into, but difficult to escape. They know that nothing makes a man or woman independent as ready cash, and that an investment in knowledge will always return the highest dividend. They know that prosperity flows only through channels that are open to receive it and that anyone can overcome poverty, but that the individual who has nothing but money confronts another form of poverty, one that can never be conquered. They know that thrift not only safeguards the future, but allows one to work with confidence. And, most important, black millionaires know that true wealth can be found in these words: make all you can, save all you can, and give all you can. These principles and laws lie at the heart of the wealth choice. Operation New Life. I have read countless books on finance and economics, and I have worked for years with the financial elite. As a result, I've found one common chord that resonates among those who control vast resources. They don't implement wealth-generating habits only when they feel the need to do so. Rather, they habitually live in a state of wealth. In other words, there is more to wealth than just learning about money. Black millionaires repeatedly take certain actions, consistently adhering to routines that allow them to create and maintain considerable wealth. They save, dream, plan, invest, and give in a never-ending cycle. Behind their routines and habits lies a basic core of beliefs, the first of which is that money is plentiful for those who understand the simple laws that govern its acquisition. On November 4, 1986, my life forever changed. Though I never met Napoleon Hill, famed author of the seminal classic Think and Grow Rich, I did meet and develop a relationship with his manager and business partner, W. Clement Stone. Stone's slicked back hair, bow tie, pencil mustache, and omnipresent cigar marked him as a creature from the roaring 20s. But when I met him in his Chicago office, he was 84 years old. His handshake was vice-like. Stone, a visionary and an icon, was once named the world's wealthiest. Seldom can a single individual affect the lives of an entire generation for the better, not to mention the lives of future generations, but Stone did so. As the founder and president of Combined Insurance Company of America, no one spoke on the subject of wealth and achievement with more authority or experience. Stone was the foremost spiritual descendant of Benjamin Franklin, Samuel Smiles, Orison Swett Marden, and the other giants in the self-help field. During our meeting, he shared a few pearls of wisdom. Desire is the beginning of all human achievement. When you go for something, don't return until you get it. Success is achieved by those who try. When there's nothing to lose by trying and everything to gain if successful, by all means try. If you cannot save 10% of all that you earn, the seeds of greatness are not in you. Prayer is mankind's greatest power. Above Stone's desk hung a portrait of George Washington kneeling in prayer before battle, a testament to Stone's lasting belief in the oldest self-help philosophy in the world. "I never engage in any action," Stone confessed, "without praying for guidance." But the Great Depression hit Stone hard. By 1937, his company's 1,000-employee sales force had shrunk to 135, and he was $28,000 in debt. As fate would have it, he was given a copy of Napoleon Hill's Think and Grow Rich. Stone devoured the book. He distributed copies to his reps and watched company revenues explode. By 1952, Stone had personally earned more than $100 million from his Combined Insurance Company of America. What was in that book? The answer to that question goes back to 1908, when author Napoleon Hill was a 25-year-old magazine reporter. During an interview, steel giant Andrew Carnegie tossed the young journalist a massive challenge. Carnegie promised Hill he would introduce him to the greatest wealth creators of his day, provided the aspiring writer would devote the next 20 years compiling their success secrets into a book. Hill would receive no pay. Moreover, in Carnegie's vast pocket was a stopwatch. He told Hill that an individual who makes fast decisions can be trusted to carry them out. If Hill hesitated more than 60 seconds, the deal was off. For the next two decades, while supporting himself through a variety of positions in sales, advertising, education, and public relations, Hill interviewed more than 500 successful men, among them Henry Ford, Charles Goodyear, John D. Rockefeller, George Eastman, Marshall Field, and Thomas Edison. His Law of Success, published in 1928, won worldwide acclaim. However, it was Hill's blockbuster, Think and Grow Rich, published nearly a decade later, that truly hit a nerve in Depression-era America. At last count, this single volume has sold more than 60 million copies. When I met Stone, I was 36 years old, married with three small children, and financially at the lowest point of my life. Prior to this encounter, I was one of those men leading a life of quiet desperation. Although I had finished college and graduate school, I was dead broke. I had spent most of our income and every dime of our savings researching and interviewing black achievers and peak performers for a book that would eventually become What Makes the Great Great. Outside of my writing, life was a living hell for me and my family. It seemed that no matter how hard my wife, Pat, and I worked, we were always in debt up to our eyeballs. But I knew life held so much more. Back in the mid-1980s, in the outskirts of Atlanta, Georgia, I lived in a nice house on a cul-de-sac overlooking a pristine wooded area surrounded by neighbors who were and are like family. As idyllic as the view was then, and still is today, I often found myself dreaming of a different view and a different life. Not necessarily a better life, but a richer, fuller one. I wanted to see all that this world has to offer, to know some of the most interesting people, and to experience, learn, and truly grow as an individual. Quite simply, I wanted to succeed, especially spiritually and financially, though I wasn't sure exactly what success meant. I didn't realize it at the time, but I was about to take a long step into the future. Slowly but surely, word got out about my research. Because there was such an obvious void in the literature, I was asked to write a series of articles about the wealth creators at the center of the study. As fate would have it, one such article found its way onto the pages of Success magazine. Finally, in spite of all the tough years, I was earning a living as a writer. 1 year later, another break came my way. The Napoleon Hill Foundation caught wind of my writings, and out of the blue, I received Stone's phone call requesting a meeting in his palatial Chicago office. As Carnegie did with Napoleon Hill, Stone not only sought out me, an unknown writer, but he guided my development through his personal philosophy and principles while providing me with the offer of a lifetime to update and complete Hill's final work, a spin-off of his greatest effort, dedicated solely to the economic advancement of Black America. On November 4, 1986, the day I walked into Stone's office, I hoped that he would see my ambition and strong desire to learn and know, qualities I knew he admired and valued. My curiosity is perhaps the character trait of which I am most proud. I am and always have been intrigued by those men and women who, by dint of their own talent, creativity, promise, and perseverance, reached impressive goals and objectives and amassed high levels of wealth as a well-deserved byproduct of their accomplishments. Interestingly enough, the most successful people I have met along my journey share this one critical element: boundless, near insatiable curiosity. When it comes to growth, success, human development, and receiving all that life has to offer, they simply need to know. When Think and Grow Rich, A Black Choice, was released in 1991, I set a simple yet achievable goal: to turn one-time victims into victors and to transform the least, the last, and the lost into peak-performing, high-achieving men and women. Operation New Life was what Wally Amos, the chocolate chip cookie tycoon, called the moment. You are going to create a new and improved you. Turn the page, Amos urged, and get started on the greatest journey of your life. True success, I added, is guaranteed when each of us discovers our inherent purpose, lives courageously, utilizes our creative gifts, and incorporates integrity into everything we do. To increase the prospects of both prosperity and personal empowerment, I identified 12 surefire principles that would set anyone onto the fast track of success. Along the way, with my follow-up effort, What Makes the Great Great, again through countless interviews with Black America's best and brightest, I've constantly refined and expanded my inquisition to include practical advice, as well as pearls of wisdom. We all possess the seeds of greatness, I pointed out. What Makes the Great Great provides the tools to discover and nourish those seeds. As of this writing, I am happy to report that both works have been enthusiastically embraced by people from all walks of life, from private and professional associations to churches, colleges, and the nonprofit sector. And with this book, the message has widened. The Wealth Choice. Each year, approximately 50,000 manuscripts find their way to editors' desks and are eventually published. Bookstores generally contain about 15,000 different titles. And yet, of all the books you could be listening to, you chose The Wealth Choice. Is it fate, luck, chance, or coincidence? I don't believe it is any of these things. Nothing is coincidental. I am convinced that many times during the course of our lives, the Creator challenges us to be more and do more than what we thought possible. I know nothing of your particular circumstances, whether you are young or old, male or female, rich or poor. I do know, however, that you are in search of a better life and increased abundance. What I am about to reveal to you has until now been known by only a fortunate few. Ironically, this key has evaded both the educated and the illiterate. Some who have been blessed with this wisdom have rejected it. They resist it and refuse to listen, just as you may wish to do. This is your chance. Forget the past and welcome this day. You would be wise to understand that at any moment the decisions you make can alter the course of your life forever. If you follow the instructions outlined in this audiobook, the results will be automatic. You'll suddenly realize that you are capable of achieving, earning, and possessing far more than you ever thought possible. And you will realize your potential simply by applying the 7 laws of wealth, million-dollar habits of men and women who have gone from rags to riches in one generation. I beg you to adhere to the words written by business philosopher Jim Rohn. Let others lead small lives, but not you. Let others argue over small things, but not you. Let others cry over small hurts, but not you. Let others leave their future in someone else's hands, but not you. And remember the 4 things that never return: the spoken word, the speeding arrow, the wasted life, and the neglected opportunity. Now the choice is yours. The Start of a New Revolution. Since its publication, more than 500,000 readers have purchased a copy of Think and Grow Rich, A Black Choice. If history is any guide, perhaps half of them ever bothered to open the book. 200,000 may have read as much as a chapter or two or heard me speak. 100,000 were diligent enough to absorb it from cover to cover. 10,000 dog-eared a page, highlighted a few passages, or wrote notes in the margin. Believe me, I know. After my many speaking events, I am regularly asked to sign books. Through my unscientific poll, the number of copies featuring bent pages and highlighted is shockingly low. But regardless of how many readers actually absorbed and heeded my writings, or failed to do so, a new revolution is about to take place. The zeal to do something, to implement a new approach, to take the first step along a new path is clear. Let me explain. Nearly 3 years ago, as I prepared to catch a flight from Atlanta's Hartsfield-Jackson Airport, I received a phone call. One of the top investment houses in the nation wanted to partner with me in an effort to reach a little-known and untapped market segment, Black America's wealthiest. At a minimum, men and women whose annual household income exceeded $250,000, and in particular, those who have reached millionaire status. The game plan was simple enough. Leaning on my name recognition as a draw, I would serve as the opening act to roughly 300 invited guests in 7 different cities. Once I concluded my remarks, a company representative, usually a high-ranking senior vice president, would share his or her insights on the economy and present the firm's wide array of financial services. Each 90-minute session closed with cocktails, hors d'oeuvres, and small talk. It was during the small talk with these financial high flyers that the subject of my next book revealed itself, and I accepted the proposal. It would be a study that would shatter many cherished misguided beliefs, including a widely held notion that wealth and financial independence are the result of some mysteriously jealously guarded secret, or, even more insidiously, that wealth is the result of being blessed with superior intelligence, talents or skills, influence or good luck. Wealth, as stated clearly by the millionaires I met during my initial presentations, is the result of a mindset that embraces tried and true habits backed by consistent and persistent action. In this book, I argue that a revolution is imminent, wherein the average American, particularly African Americans, are rethinking the tried and, as it turns out, not so true keys to wealth creation. Historically, at the heart of all revolutions stands no more than a handful of committed souls. Perhaps among them today are those 10,000 who have underlined key points in Think and Grow Rich, A Black Choice. However, now is the time to begin a new phase. the urge to do something, anything, is clear. A quick glance at the data I describe spells out what needs to be done. Before you listen any further, allow me to offer a word of advice. You may want to release, or at least reconsider, any preconceived notions you've held regarding blacks, whites, and money. For starters, consider these statistics. According to a 2009 Pew Research Center study, the median wealth of white households was 20 times that of black households and 18 times that of Hispanic households. These lopsided wealth ratios are the largest since the federal government began publishing such data in the 1980s. White's 20-to-1 wealth advantage over African Americans has been known to buffer and soften any economic downturns in the economy. Moreover, the net worth of black households fell from $12,124 in 2005 to $5,677 in 2009, a decline of 53%. Surprisingly, more than one-third of black, 35%, households had zero net worth during the same period. Approximately 35% of African Americans had no wealth or were in debt in 2009. To magnify this point, the Consumer Federation of America calculated that 25% of U.S. households were wealth poor, holding net assets less than $10,000. This statistic is a far cry from the 45% of black households that fall into this category. Home ownership rates are highest for whites, 74%, and lowest for blacks, 46%. Strikingly, black unemployment rates are twice those of whites, and the median black family's net worth stands at $8,300, a fraction of that of white households at $56,000. 24% of African Americans spend more than their income, compared with only 14% of all Americans. 32% of blacks don't save at all. Less than one-fourth of all Americans fail to do so. To underscore these statistics, according to Earl Graves Jr., CEO of Black Enterprise magazine, blacks are six times more likely than whites to purchase a Mercedes-Benz automobile. Furthermore, Graves continues, the average income of an African American who buys a Jaguar is nearly one-third less than that of a white purchaser of the same luxury vehicle. Nearly one-third of white households own 401k or thrift savings accounts, compared with less than one-fifth of African American households. Moreover, white households are more likely to own stocks and mutual funds, 31.9%, as IRA or KEO accounts, 27.5%. 10% or less of African Americans own these assets, and their median value, $8,000, is far below that of whites, $20,000. When using the term millionaire, few tracking institutes or organizations refer to those with investments in excess of $1 million. Investments include such income-bearing tools as stocks, bonds, mutual funds, equity shares in private businesses, annuities, net cash value of life insurance policies, mortgages, certificates of deposit, treasury bills, savings bonds, money markets, checking accounts, cash, as well as gold and other precious metals. Basically, anything of value that is reasonably liquid. Capgemini, a French-based information technology firm, defines a millionaire as anyone with investable assets of $1 million or more, excluding primary residence. By their conservative measure, nearly 10 million millionaires exist worldwide. Credit Suisse, the international financial services conglomerate, asserts that a millionaire is an individual whose net assets exceed $1 million. The Credit Suisse Global Wealth Report estimates that 24 million such people exist across the globe, which equates to more millionaires than the number of people living in Australia. Some 41% of these wealth creators reside in the United States, 10% live in Japan, and 3% live in China. Closer to home, according to the Federal Reserve, this is not the traditional way of expressing a household's level of wealth. In the context of wealth creation, home ownership and equity, the appraised value of the home minus the mortgage owed proves to be the most valuable and widely held asset. Against this backdrop, in 2000, nearly three-quarters, 74% of white households held home equity. In contrast, fewer than one-half of African Americans are homeowners. To compound matters, whites are three times more likely to own rental property than black Americans, as well as to own and operate a business, 12% compared to 3.4%. Black Americans spend more than $700 billion annually, yet black-owned businesses receive less than one-half of 1% of all sales receipts generated in the United States. According to the 2007 Federal Survey of Business Owners, of the 1.9 million black-owned firms, 1.8 million are classified as sole proprietorships. The average receipts for these non-employee firms were a paltry $21,270. And if the future weren't bleak enough, according to a 2009 Child Trends Research Brief Report, 34.5% of African American children, compared with only 11% of whites, are raised in poverty. Once upon a time, immigrants who traveled to this country thought that the streets in America were paved with gold. These newcomers believed that fame and fortune were possible to anyone who was armed with an idea, who backed his or her dreams with hard work and determination, and who stayed true to the guiding principles on which this country was built. Eventually, experience demonstrated that this wouldn't be true for everyone. But what is true is that wealth and prosperity come to those who know where to look for it. The high net worth men and women outlined in this study, more than 1,000 black millionaires, know where to look. Study population and methodology. As I repeated throughout my presentations, I was thrilled and honored to be selected as a spokesperson for such a series of events. And my reasoning was simple. From the earliest days of humanity, humankind has been comprised of two camps, the haves and have-nots. Since childhood, I've been obsessed with learning what invisible barrier, if any, separates the two camps. Why are some people rich and others poor? Why are some individuals well off financially while others continually struggle to make ends meet? When I asked the adults who lived in my neighborhood, to my amazement, they knew little about wealth creation and money management. They simply repeated what they had been told or what they thought to be true. Either you have it or you don't. As a have-not, I wanted to know why so few African Americans managed to climb to the ranks of the wealthy, specifically the 1%, in a land where financial freedom, regardless of race, creed, or color, is allegedly available to all. Case in point. More than 25 years ago, my father died absolutely broke. Despite attending college and working nonstop for nearly 30 years, I remembered wondering how, in a country brimming with opportunities and endless possibilities, anyone could work so hard during his or her life and end up with little or nothing before falling into the lap of Social Security. That was the moment I promised myself that it would never happen to me. Regardless of how long or how hard I had to search, how many books I was forced to read, or how many people I had to ask, I was determined to uncover the key to financial freedom and wealth creation. And now the answer that I and so many others seek is closer than we think. During these talks, I questioned each invited guest. In the process, I compiled enough life-altering information to fill several notebooks as I attempted to draw a composite picture of Black America's wealthy and financially independent population. I spoke with the old and the young, male and female, educated and uneducated, the professional and the working class, doctors, lawyers, accountants, business owners, college graduates, as well as high school dropouts, corporate executives, high-achieving men and women of all types. Each proved what is possible when you possess clarity of purpose, backed by persistence, determination, and an indefatigable commitment to a program of wealth creation and financial investing. In short, Black millionaires adhere to 9 key disciplines while creating their fortunes. The 9 disciplines of black millionaires. I am often asked what common traits I observed as I interviewed many of today's black wealthy. Amazingly, the answer is simple because nearly all successful men and women share 2 common factors. 1. A relentless commitment to lifelong learning and 2. A tenacity of purpose. In other words, tightly crafted goals matched with the discipline to achieve them. The difference between the haves and have-nots does not rest with possessions or lack thereof. No, the disparity can be found in their individual life's purpose and what each group is willing to do to attain its goals. How can you apply these fundamental truths? By deciding what your long-term financial goals are and working toward them one step at a time. When I first took on this project, my goal was to provide a roadmap for financial growth and development, a textbook that would be packed with the best and the latest insight into the behaviors and mindset of Black America's financial elite. I want to arm you, the listener, with the skills and strategies that lead to abundance and prosperity. I want you to refer to this audiobook again and again, knowing that you will find exactly what you need at just the right moment. But, most important, I want you to become aware of the 9 disciplines. Internalize character traits and attributes that all black millionaires share and practice, with the hope that you will incorporate these principles into your life. Discipline 1. Be passionate and focus on unique strengths. Develop clear, delineated goals. Each of us is driven, to some degree, by the mantra, "Get a life." But millionaires have done that and more. The wealthy have discovered a cause, a consuming, almost obsessive purpose that drives them to try, to do, to grow, and to expand. They got a life, and not just any life, but a blessed life. A good and productive life, a life that is fearless, that isn't burdened by risk or the possibility of failure, a life wherein they are willing not only to take a leap of faith, but to keep that faith through daily prayer, a life that can be still while listening for God's voice, a life that asks not for material possessions, but for guidance, knowledge, and wisdom, a life that is overflowing with self-control, confidence, and discipline, a life that focuses on its unique strengths and refuses to undertake tasks where it cannot perform at its best. In other words, a life that is motivated by the question, where can I apply my talents and gifts to render the best advantage? A life built with warmth and laughter. A life not based on money but built on adding value and service. Or, as one respondent shared, never do anything for the sake of money. If you find a vocation that you really love and adds value, take my word for it. Money will find you. A life filled with compassion and generosity. A life that is glorious and cannot be taken for granted. At their core, today's black financial elite view themselves less as wealthy or successful and more as individuals who have worked hard to pursue their passion. In my focus groups, they spoke at length about the importance of loving their work, establishing meaningful goals, and enjoying what they do. It shouldn't be necessary to ask people if they enjoy their work. Their faces should answer the question without words. It was a passion that set the actions of the Atlanta, Georgia-based Pascal Brothers apart from so many entrepreneurial startups. In 1947, James and Robert Pascal opened a 30-seat luncheonette in the heart of downtown Atlanta, where they sold sandwiches and sodas. As their business grew, they expanded the menu to include both lunch and dinner. Owning neither a stove nor a car, or even the basic necessities, they prepared the food at their home and had it delivered to the luncheonette by cab. Both Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and future President Bill Clinton strategized their next political moves over Pascal's fried chicken and peach cobbler. Passion caused Byron E. Lewis to dive headfirst into an uncertain global marketplace. When Lewis launched the UniWorld Group in 1969, the agency's existence was a radical notion. Marketing to African Americans and Latinos? At the time, these two ethnic groups comprised less than 20% of the U.S. population. Today, ethnic and segmented markets are the market, and Uniworld, the oldest multicultural marketing agency in the country, continues to be the trendsetter. Nearly 30 years after its launch, Lewis's agency boasts annual billings of more than $133 million and provides a wide array of in-house advertising, public relations, event marketing, broadcast production, and entertainment-oriented services. And what is Lewis's secret? He clearly is intoxicated with his work, completely absorbed. Passion never has to beg for advancement, he explained during a conference keynote that I attended. The individual who masters his trade and is engaged in his work will be escorted to the front. Discipline 2. Autonomous and independent. Deep need for internal control. Highly motivated self-starters. Whenever I am asked what I believe is the purpose of life, my response is the same. Of all the great earthly pursuits, one resides head and shoulders above the rest. Every virtue, treasure, and reward in life is obtained only through this quest. Simply stated, it is fulfilling your potential. Robert Louis Stevenson, the 19th century Scottish writer, said it best, "To become what we are capable of becoming is the only end in life." Unfortunately, most people deny life's endless possibilities and fail to exploit their God-given gifts. There is an anonymous quote that the greatest waste in the world is the difference between who we are and what we could have become. And what is our response to this underutilized and discarded time and effort? Abraham Maslow, the father of third force psychology, wrote, "If you plan on being anything less than you are capable of being, you'll probably be unhappy all the days of your life." The emerging picture from this study does more than suggest that the black financial elite are intensely goal-oriented. They are also ambitious self-starters who possess a deep need for internal control of their lives. They know what they want, and they are focused single-mindedly on achieving their objectives. For the most part, the wealthy adhere to the unwritten rule of financial success. It doesn't matter where you come from. All that matters is where you're going. And where you are going is determined solely by your thoughts and actions. When asked for his prescription to success, a Dallas, Texas-based millionaire replied, "I get up early, stay up late, and do a whole bunch in between." Another member of his peer group chimed in, "I discovered that the best way for me to predict my future is to create it. It serves no purpose to either play it safe or small. If that means that I must continually grow and stretch myself, so be it." By definition, these men and women are self-made. In short, they take complete responsibility for the outcome of their lives, regardless of their struggles and failures. The two words you will never hear the wealthy utter are, "if only." This habit alone allows them to rise from obscurity to positions of power and influence. Discipline 3. Industrious, strong work ethic, bias for action. What is the one attribute that all millionaires exhibit? What quality is the bedrock of their financial success? What is the one feature that translates into prosperity and abundance? Hard work! The affluent have adapted this positive, compulsive behavior in the belief that sacrifice, grit, and toil produce character, integrity, and value. As one respondent emphatically stated, "You can always work your way out of poverty and failure." Another participant who scoffed at the current market downturn continues to set the pace on Wall Street as an investment banker. In between my classes, he visited me in my office long enough to share his keys to success. "It seems so cliché," he said, "but it's true. You'd be surprised how much money you could earn if you'd only show up. You can have anything in life that you desire as long as you are willing to earn it." Millionaires love their work, and they love to work. Nearly each member of the seven-figure club knows both victory and defeat, but their ambition, persistence and drive, and ceaseless appreciation for hard work have earned them millions in spite of the occasional bump in the road. and they lead by example. When asked what term describes them best, nearly 3 out of 4 respondents cited hard work. And to further underscore the point, regardless of their vocation, the majority in this study said they identified with the label hardworking. As a boy growing up in Dayton, Ohio, Henry Parks, the marketing genius who would blaze the trail for future black entrepreneurs, saw a sign hanging outside a neighborhood store. Boy wanted. Young Parks immediately removed the sign and walked boldly inside. The store owner indignantly asked what he meant by removing the sign. "You won't need it anymore," Parks asserted. "I'm going to take the job." And he took it. Tyler Perry has made no secret of the pains he expended as he created his most memorable scenes in his films. It is said that Alex Haley rewrote Roots dozens of times, and even then he was unsatisfied. He would cut, splice, and edit whatever he wrote until he was completely satisfied. Maya Angelou would spend weeks over a single sentence. Lisa Nichols, hours over a word. Toni Morrison, a month over a short composition. And E. Lynn Harris thought 4 lines were a good day's work. During a Crown Forum Symposium lecture at Morehouse College, his alma mater, Spike Lee gave the secret to his success, both professionally and financially. "Hard work and perseverance made me what I am today," he shared as he stood before a room packed with ambitious students. "I am most fulfilled when pursuing my labor of love." Hard work is the parent of all worthwhile endeavors, whether in business or the arts. If the wealthy can offer a fresh beatitude to the 8 blessings provided in the book of Matthew, it would be, "Blessed are those who have found their work." Wealth will never open its doors to those who are unwilling to pay the price in terms of sweat, sacrifice, and hard work. Discipline 4. Creativity and innovation. Recognize the powers of ideas. Innovate or die? I know that sounds dramatic, and while you might not physically die, your greater hopes and dreams and your chances to accomplish your big goals will. Innovation has always separated leaders from followers, those who succeed and those who just get by. Innovation is what creates progress, and progress is what advances companies and people beyond the competitive herd of the masses, average, and the status quo. Innovation is not a task, project, or something you only do at an off-site meeting. Innovation is a constant mindset and perspective. It's a way of looking at the world. Instead of seeing what is, it is looking for what could be. Being an innovator is seeking the greater potential in every person, in every situation, process, experience, and outcome. The fundamental desire of an innovator is to help, serve, and solve. Damon John can neither sing nor dance, so in his early 20s, using his inexhaustible creative power, he hooked into the burgeoning 1980s rap scene in New York as his path to success. John worked as a roadie for renowned rappers Run DMC and LL Cool J, and in the process discovered his enthusiasm for fashion. As the founder of the urban clothing line FUBU, For Us, By Us, John built his empire with determination, creative marketing, and groundbreaking branding strategies. Known as the godfather of urban fashion, John runs a number of multi-million dollar clothing enterprises while offering branding expertise to some of the top companies and celebrities in the world. However, as recently as 1992, John wasn't successful or wealthy. Far from it. He had little direction and almost no understanding of the apparel industry. What he did possess, however, was a strong desire to utilize his creative skills and revolutionize the sportswear industry by branding a distinctive line of jerseys, jeans, and outerwear with a decidedly urban appeal. After pricing competitive brands, he decided to design and manufacture his own line instead. At breakneck speed, he began sewing his logo onto every piece of clothing he could produce, hats, hockey jerseys, sweatshirts, and t-shirts, before even considering a marketing strategy. In 1998, FUBU raked in more than $350 million in revenue. John's business ventures have brought in more than $4 billion in sales since the line was released. He is amused by the nickname Godfather of Urban Fashion, but knows that it is a result of his relentless effort, determination, and knowledge of what it takes to build a successful business. I've learned, especially in this industry, that all aspects of this business revolve around preparation, sales, and marketing. I was rejected by 27 banks. I was turned down because I was poorly prepared. I didn't know what potential investors needed to see. I didn't know how to write a business plan. I had no concept of business forecasting and strategic planning. To be blunt, I didn't know a thing. But it was a learning curve, and the only skill set that is more expensive than education is ignorance. I now know what the wealthy and affluent have known all along. The marketplace pays for results, not effort. In other words, focus on the future and keep the ideas flowing. Anything and everything can be branded, he shared during our interview. And what lies at the heart of an effective brand? Creativity and innovation. Your ability to develop ideas, connect with others, and impact the bottom line. Discipline 5. Never consider the possibility of failure. If you are afraid to fail, I suggest that you listen no further. Turn off this audiobook and retreat back to the huddled masses, to the humbled crowd, to the status quo. Each day, countless obscure men and women march to their graves simply because timidity and lack of courage prevented them from trying or taking a chance. Even worse, the fear of failure stopped them. Perhaps the greatest common trait among the wealthy is their willingness to face failure and rejection, and their resilience in picking themselves up and moving on. Self-made millionaires are realistic enough to expect challenges and setbacks. Further, they do not become discouraged or depressed by difficulties or temporary defeat. Mention the word risk to a millionaire, and he or she will only hear the term money. As a result, they find promise where others find pessimism. As one respondent shared, in the process of chasing your dream, optimism is not a luxury but a necessity. They know that success builds character, but failure reveals it. Failure is never fatal. It's the down payment you pay for success. Growing up in the housing projects of Omaha, Nebraska, neighbors told Nathaniel Goldston that he would never rise above anything more than a head waiter. 30 years later, Goldston, the chief executive officer, CEO, of Gourmet Food Services, was in charge of a company that surpassed the $170 million mark. It mattered not who or what stood in his path, not ridicule, poverty, or the possibility of humiliating defeat would deter him. Over the course of my career, I've failed more times than I can count, Goldston admitted during our interview, and each time failure has always rendered a special gift. It's called wisdom. So if at first you don't succeed, welcome to the club. There's little point in dismissing an idea by saying it might fail. Any idea might fail. If you're committed to achieving your financial goals, you'll suffer your fair share of failure. Bank on it. Discipline 6. Inquisitive, strong desire to know, quick to absorb and apply new information. During a time when society's reading habits wane, both at home and in school, and as television viewing steadily increases, the wealthy shun this wasteful habit and continue their never-ending quest to grow, study, and absorb new information. So many people fail to increase their earnings because they don't make financial literacy a priority. According to the Nielsen Wire, the global leader in consumer insights, the average African-American household spends more than 7 hours each day, 40% more than the overall population, and nearly 9 times that of the average black millionaire, watching television. The wealthy, however, read nearly 2 books per month. And the genre? Mostly history, biographies, or money management. Basically any subject or topic that might provide advice, useful information, or cautionary tales. As you've learned by now, a formal education is not required to join the seven-figure club. Truth be told, a handful of the multimillionaires in this study never ventured past the 10th grade. Although I found these men and women to be no more gifted than others, each had developed an insatiable desire for knowledge and information. They stand out because they had taken the time to prepare, to read and study, and to develop their full potential without the benefit of formal schooling. Affirming a commitment to wealth means becoming a student of wealth. You must learn the language of money. It means living by this maxim: if you wish to be wealthy, you must study the acquisition of wealth. The millionaires among us are inquisitive. Their curiosity propels them forward. They take classes to augment their financial literacy and ask for advice from those who are where they want to be. The wealthy possess a voracious hunger for knowledge and absolutely no appetite for ignorance. Discipline 7. Strong sales skills. Sell is not a four-letter word. Millionaires not only openly engage in the sales process, they embrace the activity. Although some may detest being labeled a salesperson, those profiled in the study are proud of the term. Why? Because the selling process is the most effective and efficient way to increase your earnings and reach your financial goals. In short, sales equals income. The black financial elite are thoroughly prepared, completely engaged sales professionals, tough enough to deal with any rejection, resilient enough to overcome any objection, and caring enough to help customers and clients achieve their goals. For this special group, selling takes on a positive, proactive, and even creative aura. It provides continual opportunities to understand real customer needs, to be responsive to changes in the market, and to create value, a subject I touch upon in Chapter 5. The wealthy know that selling is not just a business skill, but an essential life skill. They live by this mantra: nothing occurs until somebody sells something. Nothing. Hear me
loud. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.